All right, next up we have using texting to engage and connect with anglers and boaters. We have several presenters for this, followed by a bit of a panel Q&A. We will first hear from Angie Peterson and Nick Geyer from the Granicus Experience Group. Angie is the group's vice president, leading Granicus' agency of experienced strategists, data analysts, content creators, and technologists to help their government customers better connect communications and experience for more measurable impact. Angie is an experienced designer, executive, and change agent who is passionate about transformation journeys of all types and sizes. Nick Geyer is a manager at the Granicus Experience Group, leading the team's platform initiatives and projects. With more than 12 years' experience with Granicus, Nick has led some of Granicus's most technically complex and impactful projects.
Hi, everyone. Man, I'd love to start just with quick show of hands. I know, you know, Joanne introduced us. We're from Granicus. Does anyone actually here work with GovDelivery? Ah, yes. Okay, great. GovDelivery is our flagship product. So we are always thrilled to be here in a room full of GovDelivery customers and users, and that's part of what we're going to be talking about is how to integrate SMS, text messaging into all of your other sort of outbound communication strategies. So this, you know, Granicus is doing a lot beyond GovDelivery. We have a lot of solutions for web, email, forms, all of the things, right? But we're here to talk about how to integrate text into the work that you're doing. So anyone want to just take a quick stab? We love a little bit of trivia. Anyone want to take a quick stab at how many SMS messages our customers sent out last year? Ballpark, anyone? 20,000? 8 million? 16 million? 16 million? Yeah? All right, team. 765 million. So the notion of moving in this direction, right? All of our customers, government only, federal, state, local, city, county, but people are really starting to embrace text as a great channel to add to your marketing communications to really engage a variety of different audiences and for a variety of different reasons, right? And that's part of what we'll get into, aligning the channel to the need in the audience. So, you know, when we think about doing that, we understand that that can actually, just adding a channel can actually still create more chaos. And there's a lot of hoops and steps and processes that people go through to secure a permit or a license. Sometimes we're talking about it from like even like securing a passport or getting your driver's license renewed, but the act of actually renewing your permit and your license in a boating and fishing and, context is still the same. Just adding a channel doesn't necessarily create clarity, right? So part of what we're trying to do is think about how might we incorporate SMS so that it does add to that clarity. It does actually drive people to certainly get their permit, their license, but also develop and foster that broader sense of being a lifelong enthusiast of the sport. So that instead of it feeling like this and chaotic, communications can be used to help people feel much more guided, they can feel respected, remembered, reminded, all of those things, which is a point of view we often share, but in the context of this, does not feel far off from feeling that they have been recruited and retained and reactivated. So one of the frameworks, we talked through this in our breakout session yesterday too, but one of the frameworks that we use when we're thinking about building, you know, communications across multiple channels and to a variety of different audiences is this kind of four-step framework or four-phase framework. And we'll talk more about it as Nick gets into the details of SMS, but we heard a lot over the last couple of days about doing a lot from social media, earned media, advertising, all of that is like huge from an awareness building effort, right? And making sure that the messages about the value of fishing, the value of getting your permit, all of those things, the feel good feelings that you want to convey to people to persuade them to become fishers is something that happens at that awareness stage. And part of what we're going to talk about is how to move from awareness down into more of that action driving. So really connecting email and SMS all together, along with the other efforts and the other channels to really drive people to take those actions that we're trying to get to. So I'm going to toss to Nick.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. Nick Geyer. Nice to be here. We've heard so much about how to engage with these audiences, right? So much about the expert knowledge, the great stories that you have to tell. So we're going to focus today on how we use SMS or text messaging specifically as a unique channel and what opportunity that presents along with it. So text messaging as a channel is direct. You know, people have it in their phone and it's not going into a general inbox, it's in your text message thread, right? It's immediate, people are getting those notifications in an almost real-time basis, and it's a distinct channel. It's more potent in many ways. It has more considerations and requirements than other outbound channels like email, like social media. So looking at the sense of mobile phone ownership and trends over time, you know, the gap between smartphone ownership and just mobile phone ownership in general is starting to close. Cell phones plateaued many years ago, you know, but we start to see this really drastic increase around 2011, where 9 in 10 people now own a smartphone. And what does that mean? It gives people more access to online experiences, more complex and robust things that you're doing on your phone, like enrolling in things, buying things on your phone. Certainly sharing and connecting to all those powerful social media channels. So people are carrying these devices around with them, 9 out of 10 for Americans, US adults. For many, it's their only access. So while there's been improvements in broadband access across the US, sometimes it's starting to plateau in certain demographics and areas. So this is an interesting breakdown from Pew, where it's around 16% of the US population relies entirely upon a smartphone to access the internet. They don't have broadband at the home. So considering the widespread use of mobile technology and some people's reliance on it, again, presenting some powerful opportunities to use it as a channel to connect with these audiences that we all know so well. People are online constantly. We all probably know someone who's probably too online. 9 in 10 adults go on, or 8 in 10 adults go online constantly every day. Opt-in rates across SMS marketing. So the opt-in rates over the last several years have actually increased to 52% in the bottom right chart there. So businesses are seeing an increased adoption by their customers and consumers as well to opting into text messaging. It's, you know, we see it every day and in ordering a pizza, for example. That's just like a more ubiquitous thing that people have and experience and expect. From Salesforce, you know, there's tons of data out there about the potency of and conversion rates around SMS. And the timeliness of it, right? People are responding to text messages on average within 90 seconds versus 90 minutes in an email inbox that's jumbled with a bunch of other tabs and conversations going on. So again, it's a distinct, it's an immediate, and it's a very direct form of communication and channel. All that put together, what does that mean? It's a very effective. So how do we leverage this opportunity to connect with these priority audiences? That's what we want to kind of spend a good amount of time today about the approach, right? Like, how do we do this? These are learnings that we've been distilling from running SMS campaigns with our customers over the many years. Lessons learned, highs, lows, pitfalls. So we're gonna lay out some things to know. So like going on any trip on the water, we wanna make sure we're planned and prepared and have the proper things and gear and know where we're going. So knowing the water, knowing the rules, regulations, pitfalls to avoid to keep ourselves happy out there. And know where we're going. If we're going to go anywhere, we need to chart our course. So if we're just getting started with SMS marketing, you're not doing it currently as a channel, there's some things to know as you're getting started. So you'll need to define first, step A number one is to define your specific use case. What are we going to be sending in text messaging? This is going to be going into your application for the phone number. And very important to define and get tight right out of the gate in terms of like what are we going to be sending in our content. You need to have functioning wireless terms and conditions page on your website, a privacy policy. Maybe these need to be amended with language that has disclaimers and disclosures about the fact that you'll be collecting cell phone numbers and using SMS as a channel. And then those opt-in and consent mechanisms, right? So a requirement of SMS marketing is that these people are opting into communications. So how are we going to capture those people, and how are they going to provide that positive and traceable consent to being able to be text messages? So these are some foundational things that we need to get in place before we consider, you know, what phone number we're going to be using. So there's a couple different options that you can use if you're in the area of about 35,000 messages per day, or for a total audience. A 10-digit long code would suffice. This is a localized area code, or you can also use a toll-free number for that volume. If you're surpassing 35,000, you need to get more messages out per day, for instance, then you're in the high-volume toll-free number territory. The best in class being the short code. This is a 5 or 6 number, phone number that you probably see in your phone from, you know, various opt-ins that you've done yourself. It has benefits like improved UX for things like text to subscribe, higher throughput, brand recognition and trust as a short code versus a long code. So it also comes with higher scrutiny and regulation. So we'll kind of focus on using short codes as our measurement for how we stay in compliance and good standing and best practices. So, I mean, look at this little fellow. He's stoked to be in the short code boat for sure. So. You purchase the phone number then, and then you actually have to submit an application for that number that includes your use case, positive indication of all those opt-in mechanisms and consent, and then you're registering that phone number with the wireless carrier. So wireless carriers, as an entity, these are very big, powerful companies. They have customers that they're interested in protecting, limiting their liability in the space. So. We are inevitably beholden to the wireless providers and their decision whether or not they're going to deliver our content to their customers and protecting their users. They also coordinate and rely upon guidance that's published by the Cellular Telecommunications and Internet Association, or CTIA. They actually just want to be called CTIA now, so it's a cooler and more brief. TCPA Act, excuse me, and CAN-SPAM, the CAN-SPAM Act of 2003, are all like very serious regulations that are also on the books. So when we're talking about things to know and avoid in terms of wireless compliance, we need to know the water. We need to know like where we're going, and these rules and regulations main components. So we'll focus on the three areas that are used or analyzed, and we need to make sure are in place to stay within compliance. It's the opt-in. We've talked about a little bit about that, the requirement of these being opted-in phone numbers and how those are collected, whether it's on a website or various other forms of capture. The confirmation message that's happening immediately after that sign up, we would maybe call it a welcome message. And then the message flow, what's actually being sent in the course of the content and text messaging. Opt-in requirements on this screen, so if this is on your website or on an offline resource like a poster or something, anywhere where you're presenting text to subscribe, for example, anywhere that short code or phone number opt-in is present, these need to be there. A description of the product, terms and conditions, and privacy policy, which we talked about. Message and data rates apply disclaimer, the stop keyword, and they also like to see frequency listed for short codes. So these all have to be in place and have to demonstrate these to get your short code approved, even if you're applying for a new one. That opt-in confirmation message, right? So someone would call it a welcome message. It's not very welcomey. It has a lot of these requirements that are in there. So you have to have the brand name, customer care contact, or a contact link, message and data rates apply disclosure again, message frequency, opt-out information, all in the less than 160 characters. So again, not very welcoming. Follow-up touches or targeted welcome campaigns after that are a general best practice too, because you have to get this out of the way right away when someone signs up. This is like 135 characters, by the way, so you don't have very much room to play with after that. Other required keywords, the help and the opt-out confirmation response. The instructions to opt out, so stop to cancel, need to be sent at regular intervals. It's according to the CTIA handbook. So monthly or on a recurring basis, having those stop to cancel instructions in your content keeps you in good standing. Again, we're talking a lot about scary stuff, but these are really serious things, because if you're not in compliance and your short code gets audited and sometimes blocked by carriers, trust me, it's not a pleasurable spot to be in. So not using public short URLs, so it has to be proprietary or a paid or owned account of, can't just go to bit.ly.com and whip up a free URL. That will get blocked at the carrier levels more often than not. Shaft language, so sexual and hateful, hopefully that's easily avoidable. But in our audience, alcohol, firearms, tobacco, especially in government, you sometimes see anti-smoking campaigns or resources for alcoholism get blocked or flagged by wireless carriers. These are all regulations and rules that we're beholden to by these companies and their customers, so we have to be mindful of it. Sweepstakes or contests, giveaways for boats and things like that are great engagement opportunity, but some additional disclaimers and disclosures have to be in place if you're marketing SMS about sweepstakes. So if you are in an audit, or what auditors will look at, they'll look at your opt-in, they'll look at the welcome message that gets, they'll literally test it and see if they get the welcome message, and then they'll try to unsubscribe. And if those three components are in place, you're at risk for, again, your short code being audited, which, trust me, want to avoid that. All right, scary stuff out of the way. Let's talk about how we're going to effectively use SMS to engage with our audiences. We need to know where we're going, right? We need to chart our course. The experience framework we use when we're trying to design human-centered experiences digitally and multi-channel, we insist upon using this methodology, being aligned with goals, understanding who our audiences are, all the different various segments and sub-personas within the audience, what those people need to do, steps they need to take, what that user journey looks like, so that we can then create content that aligns with those human-centric and empathetic events that we need to guide them through. We use the four phases of communication, right, to create that awareness and opt-in. If we look through this through an SMS lens here, how do we build and understand who our SMS audience is? How do we send them content that's going to build that trust and conversation and engagement appropriately with this channel? And how are we going to use it to guide decisions, create action, and manage, engage, retain, recruit, right? So it starts to feel very familiar to retention models. Thankfully, we have a lot of this in place thanks to RBFF and all of your expertise. Like, you know your audience and the journey and the campaigns. The workshop we ran yesterday hopefully gave you some helpful tools and tactics. We have more worksheets and things up here in front. If you weren't a part of the session, please come find them. And if you start to overlay communications over these models, and combined with the potency of SMS, you can start to see how this becomes a very good opportunity for engagement. So let's go texting, right? I love a good fishing tip myself. I'm a semi-competent angler from Minnesota, boat owner as well. So I like anyone loves a good fishing tip. So when we're moving through our engagement journey here with SMS and we're trying to build awareness and opt-in and build our SMS audience, we are using multi-channel promotion, all of our various forms of capture to present that opportunity to sign up for text alerts, keeping in mind our opt-in requirements there, but all of your digital properties present an opportunity to opt in for wireless, so posting on social media, offline channels like printed media, or events, you know, being in person with your audience. Again, all these opportunities to drive them to that opt-in experience. In practice, considering tracking and attribution at this stage very early on too, trust me, another lesson learned. So you want to understand the various sources of SMS subscribers. Did the event get people? Did the website get people? So considering where the sources of your various SMS captures is important to discern if you want to understand that audience later on. Again, in practice, things like in-person events, our customers that we love to work with at the Philadelphia Water Department, they're putting QR codes on their tables that send them to a wireless sign-up form in GovDelivery to easily sign up for SMS. Or they put a text-to-subscribe call to action on these water quality alert note cards that they're sending out, so people can leverage these four various forms of SMS capture to, again, create awareness, get opt-in. GovDelivery presents a very powerful and potent opportunity to leverage to grow your SMS audience. So someone like healthcare.gov, who has a very vast and large email audience, is sending out invitations to text to subscribe or go to this wireless sign-up form to opt in to text message alerts. Again, they're leveraging their email audience as an opportunity. Gives you a lot of control, too, to have that compliance language in there and all that good short code stuff. Our friends at Texas, Josh over here, they are using text to subscribe and in a sign-up form on the bottom of their website to integrate email and SMS so they're able to deliver these phishing reports by text. Think of your audience, right? These people are on the go. So if we're trying to reach them or trying to grow them, you got to go where they are, right? As we are then, we're in the, we've opted in, we've sent them the welcome message. We need to then, be creative with the content. Thankfully, the stories, again, the content, the compelling calls to action to go engage with the outdoors, the stories are there. So we have a lot of opportunity for content, but we have to be concise. We have to be conversational. It's a different form of communication, right? That versus a full form email. The five W's are very important here, right? So who we're talking to, understanding our segmented audiences, what do they need to know? Where are they? Why, I'm getting this text on my phone, like what do I need to do or have it out in the world or out on my boat, for example? Time of day, when, and why are you sending me a text message? So the five W's, great guidepost for like, why are we gonna send a text message? When should we? All in less than 160 characters. Segmentation being very important here too. Obviously, we could spend a ton of time on this. And SMS is, there's many ways to do it. Two main ways to segment is by persona, so understanding who our audience is, capturing that information through various forms, and being able to deliver these targeted, very specific messages that are tailored to that audience. Action or timeline-based messaging is very potent in SMS too. Americans love procrastinating, deadline messaging, for example. We have a ton of these time-based actions with registration and license purchasing, for example. So there's a little technique involved to it. You got to present a lure at the very exact right time to a fish. It has to be the right water temperature, the proper technique. So there's definitely some technique involved. There's a ton of resources out there in terms of best practices for SMS copywriting, the aligning with your journey map, for example. There we go. When we're thinking about using, again, this very direct and timely communication channel to drive action, to create decisions, some things to think about. Time of day, you're only allowed to send text message between 8 a.m. and 9 p.m. local time, so we have some early risers probably in our audiences, but the carriers flag any activity outside of that. A/B testing is a very powerful and potent tool here as well, combined with segmentation. We could spend a ton of time on this, but understanding time of day tests, morning versus evening or afternoon engagement, what are you seeing with those various audiences? Maybe Josh will spend, I think, some time on some of the A/B tests that they run. And link tracking. In SMS, it's very important because that's your ability to measure action, primarily at the link level. Did the message get to my phone? And then did I click the link or did not? That's where the tracking really comes into play with SMS. So things like short URLs are very powerful because they give you that dashboard and that ability to understand activity on links that you're including. Again, none of this matters, none of this is effective without alignment to a user journey. The journey, informs what communications we're sending out, the communications are supporting that journey, so that symbiotic relationship combined with, should I send a text message about this, is it timely and actionable, are definitely important things to consider. So you're all, marketing professionals, content calendars are your best friend or maybe worst enemy. As you create these various, schedules, driving decision and action around key dates and deadlines, registration, SMS, a powerful tool in your toolkit. So it's not everything, but timing is definitely very important. I always miss this opportunity at fishing time. And when we're then into the, engagement and management or the retention and reactivation stage of the journey, people, want to, again, receive relevant opportunities to engage with you via text. You guys have a very compelling chance to create this engagement, right? So people have this device in their phone. We talked about all the things you can do on it. Timely prompts, targeted prompts to share resources with, they literally have an address book in their hand so they can share it with their contacts, phishing maps, whatever, driving them to the various social media channels that create that good engagement, all the cool screenshots and comments that are generated. So again, combining it with the opportunity to engage with the communities that you're fostering. It's designed to be interactive as a channel. I have some text threads in my phone that are just all one-sided, but it's intended to be a back-and-forth conversation as a communications channel, not just one way. So you can do things like custom keywords, where you're prompting people to respond with various prompts that give them customized responses that direct them to various information resources that they need. Or you can use a product that's something called like two-way SMS, two-way texting, where you're creating predefined conversation pathways and then sending that outbound or inviting people to text into it so that they can answer that conversation and have a predefined conversation that's routing them to the proper things, places, information that they need. So you got to keep them hooked. Again, we have very potent and we have, I keep saying the word potent, we have a very defined and useful framework to operate off of with R3. Combining that with the best practices and thinking around the four phases of communication gives us this opportunity to create something like an engaging, conversational, direct text message that, you know, creates the experiences that we're after with these powerful audiences and great stories that you have to tell. So can't wait to hear from Josh and some of the like actual use cases of this in practice. So hopefully that answered some questions, and have come find us afterwards. So thank you very much.
Thank you. That was a lot of information in a short amount of time, and I feel a little bit overwhelmed, but I think Josh can help clarify some stuff for us as he presents information on a real life texting campaign. So Josh Lee is the email marketing manager at the Texas Park and Wildlife Department. He has played a pivotal role in developing and implementing email marketing initiatives across multiple campaigns relating to Texas's strategic R3 plan. He's spent over 15 years of marketing experience, including previous positions at two other nonprofit organizations in Austin, Texas. I'd like to bring up Josh.
Thank you, Joanne and Nick. Hello, everybody. As Joanne mentioned, my name is Joshua Lee. I'm the email marketing manager for Texas Parks and Wildlife Department. Sorry. Today, I'm going to be talking about a real-world example that Parks and Wildlife implemented using the GovDelivery platform for both SMS text messaging as well as our traditional use of email. So a little bit of background on this campaign. As Stephanie alluded to in a session this morning, which I'm sure many of you were at, churn is a huge issue amongst, I think, every state as far as fishing license buyers is concerned. That is especially true in Texas for our year from purchase, or what we call our YFP license. The YFP tends to have the longest lapse between expiration and renewal of around up to 5 months, typically. We don't know why that is. The YFP is kind of a volatile license, just the way it operates. It's not the standard, you know, everyone knows to buy their license on August 15th because the new license year started, so those people tend to buy them like clockwork. For the YFP license, if I bought one today, it would expire the end of February next year. So a lot of people tend to buy that YFP license when they need it, not when they know it's expiring. So the goal here was for us to utilize the first time we used SMS in a transactional campaign. We have used it in the past. One of the slides that Nick shared was for our weekly fishing report, and that goes out every week as a text message that links to our website so people can get the most up-to-date fishing information. So we wanted to take that idea and put it towards a transactional campaign to see if we can shorten that lapse in license renewals specifically for the YFP. So our objectives here were using this campaign to obviously retain anglers and shorten that lapse time between a license renewal. We set out with a goal based on the grant we received from RBFF for $10,000. We wanted to reach at least 200,000 existing customers to remind them that their licenses needed to be renewed. So the goal was to send multiple text messages, if needed, to those 200,000 people with a goal of reaching about 400,000 outgoing text messages. So our tactics for this were to combine the SMS messaging with our existing email campaign, as well as kind of enhance the email campaign that we had been utilizing over the last few years. So in addition to our notice of license expiration that goes out with the email, we added on a 60, 90, and 120-day interval text and email. So the way that works, if your license just expired, you would receive a text and an email saying, hey, your license expired, renew now. Then at 60, 90, and 120 days, folks that receive that initial message would keep getting reminders if they still have not renewed. Come on. There we go. So here's an example of the text message that we sent. This one was for our 120-day audience in September. We did use Bitly links. So it did work for us. Like I said, this was a brand new thing for us, so we're still learning along with the rest of you guys. We did have success with that. And as I mentioned, you can see it's a very simple, like Nick alluded to, you only have 160 characters for a text message. So the keep it simple, stupid rule applies here for sure. So what we did do is make sure we put from TPWD in hopes of legitimizing that message, because everybody gets a lot of spam text that you don't know who they're from, and most of them just immediately get deleted or report junk and delete. So the hope here was people see, oh, from TPWD, they know they have a phishing license, hopefully. So this is just the best reminder that we could come up with for that. And then, as Nick also mentioned with SMS tracking, the tracking in Gov Delivery is a little limited, no offense, guys. So we did use the Bitly link for tracking, so that allowed us almost in real time to see when people were clicking that link within our text message. You do have to refresh your browser, but you can log in. So like when the text messages went out over the period of a couple hours, I could go in and see like how many people had clicked on the original expiration, the 60, 90, and so forth. So it's kind of cool to see that reporting almost in real time. And this specific campaign ran from May through September of 2023. So it was a pretty short campaign, but based on the amount of the grant and the time frame we had, that's what we selected there. So here's an example of the expiration email that goes out. We've been using this kind of same framework for the last couple of years. We found it to be very effective. We did some A/B testing with this in the past of kind of a hard sell versus a soft sell. In this instance, the hard sell won, so it's very short to the point. Hey, your license is expired, renew it. And this one is the initial expiration, so you can see the expiration date was October, so this would have gone out the beginning of November. And then we added a little more meat to the follow-up emails. These went out at the 60, 90, and 120-day intervals. So the purpose of these was not only to remind folks that their license was expired, but also remind them all the fun things they're missing out on by not having a phishing license. So we added in things like fishing events, lake finder, where to fish, information like that. So the hopes of, oh yeah, I do miss going fishing. I should renew my license. So the results of the campaign were quite promising for our first endeavor. This is kind of a side-by-side of the groups of the time frame that these emails and texts were sent out. And I can't even read that. So as you can see, the really interesting thing here is that this campaign was sent, the text and the emails were sent to the same audience, sent separately, so we divided it amongst phone numbers and email addresses. You can see that the SMS side, actually a little over 400,000 messages were delivered, as opposed to about 350,000 on email. So what that tells us is when we opt people in, when they buy a license, we collect their email address and phone number. They're giving us a legitimate phone number more frequently than they're giving us a legitimate email. So those of you which a lot use Gov Delivery, those bounce rates that you see more often in email are prevalent because we get a lot of fake email addresses. The link tracking here, almost, I guess, over double the link clicks on the SMS side. That's that immediate thing that, you know, people get it in their hand, they click on it. The revenue difference, trackable revenue through Google Analytics, and now we use Matomo. The revenue on the SMS text side was 184,000 compared to 165 tracked through email. So with the $10,000 grant that we used to fund this SMS campaign, we had a little over a 1,700% ROI, which I think anyone would take 1,700% ROI on pretty much any marketing campaign. So we're very pleased with those results. So some of our observations, our customers are receptive to text reminders for license renewals. Multiple reminders, we did set the goal, achieve the goal we set out to achieve, which was reducing that lapse time, the lag time between renewals, and increasing our revenue. And then, as Nick also alluded to earlier, the simple, to-the-point messages are the most effective, because if people don't recognize exactly what it is, they're probably going to just pass it by. So recommendations for the future, we really want to do more testing. The A-B testing that was mentioned, we didn't do a lot of that here. We do a lot of A-B testing on the email side of things. It's something we want to get into with the text messaging, you know, whether it is time of day sends, the message itself, a link with different wording or information in the link. The big thing for us, as probably for most state agencies, is we don't have any money. Our marketing budget is pretty much nothing, so we need to get buy-in from some of our internal partners, whether it's, you know, other divisions, wildlife, inland fisheries, folks that use the platform and use it a lot, and you know, they can contribute funds to us expanding this platform. Or we would love a big discount from Granicus, if that's possible. We can talk later about that. So the good news is we did get another grant this year from RBFF for $25,000, and this text campaign is going to focus on boaters and lapsed boat registrations. So we've got a base that we learned from for the year from purchase fishing license, so we can take all that knowledge and do a bigger, better campaign for boat registrations. And that's all I've got. There's my contact information, and I guess we'll jump into the Q&A part.
Yeah, sure.
All right.
Thanks,
y'all.
Thank you very much, Josh.
No. All right, well, I have a few questions for all of you, any of you, before we open it to the audience. One thing that I've noticed is, especially for somebody or a state agency creating a campaign for the first time, I feel like it could be very cumbersome or just sound daunting. What would you say is the biggest learning curve or biggest hurdle to kind of get over in order to start that campaign creation?
I think for us, it was, like I said, we still are learning things with, you know, correct types of links and things. We did talk to our Granicus team about text capability and, you know, how many texts we have built into our contract, what are our limits, how many texts can we send, what does that kind of look like? So they helped us out from that aspect. We also spoke to Jennifer Wisniewski, formerly of Tennessee, who Tennessee did a lot of text campaigns, got some help from her. So if any of you guys are starting out with this, happy to walk you through kind of our process of being newbies in the text game. But that was the biggest thing, is just kind of getting information from GovDelivery, from Granicus, as far as, you know, best practices, and then kind of tweaking that content based on what other states have done successfully.
Great, thanks.
More than anything, too, it's the acknowledgement that it's an iterative process, and you have to have hypotheses and test them and have learnings along the way. I think what we tried to really emphasize was some of the key learnings that you can know going into it to have as sort of a roadmap, but it's your audience, and you know them better than anybody, and your ability to connect with them. So data, testing, and just the acknowledgement that you will learn along the way is important. Thankfully, too, combined with the fact that people are more receptive on the whole of SMS marketing, even compared to 5 years ago, the compliance standards are more clear. So it's a good spot to experiment in.
I'll add too, if you're getting started, it's great to try to really think and get crisp on the goal and the context of what you're trying to achieve with that first step, right? So whether it's, you know, driving for more renewals or driving people to take that action, or getting crisp on which part of your audience you're trying to target, having that clear understanding of the context of who you're sending it to, where they are, all of that, I think, is a great way to start.
Great. Well, and along those lines of, you know, who you're sending the messages to, obviously, Josh in Texas did a retention reactivation campaign. Do you have thoughts on other types of messaging or ways to target audiences depending on what your message is?
Sure. So in some of the larger scale SMS campaigns that we've been a part of that are heavily and tracked down to the detail, the way that SMS is most effectively used is to align with key dates and deadlines, essentially. In an enrollment journey, it's very applicable to many of the other experiences we're trying to create with these audiences. There is the conversational aspect of it, but where you really see the needle move in some of those measurable things like enrollment rates or purchases, aligning to deadlines is really one of the key and most effective means of SMS marketing, I'd say.
Okay. Yeah, I would say for us, some of the things I mentioned about using SMS messaging and other marketing things, so whether it's the two-way messaging that we would love to get, so, you know, thanking people when they buy a park pass and letting them know, like, hey, do you know you can do these things at this park? You can rent a kayak. So there's a lot of two-way communication that we can get into with it. Things like Big Time Texas Hunts, that's very deadline-driven. It's, you know, it opens up in May and runs through October, and, you know, buying entries for Big Time Texas Hunts. Drawn Hunts is another use there. Just state park reservations, thanking mm-hmm. them for, you know, park passes, park reservations. There's all kinds of ways we could go with SMS messaging should we get the funding to do so.
Gotcha.
And aligning all those different sub-segments or niches of or communities of your audience with with capture and opt-in that you can track and attribute, then you know who those people are. It's coming from this event or this initiative right. they are running to get more young people fishing, for
gotcha.
Example.
Yeah.
Then you have that segmentation information to then leverage to do what you're, you know, to align with those practices of targeting.
Yeah. Great, thank you. Like you mentioned, people coming in at events, and that Josh, for when you guys sell your licenses, people can check a box and give their phone number, and then, you know, they're opting in to receive these text messages. Do you all have thoughts or suggestions on other ways to get messages or to get phone numbers to opt in? I know a lot of states host a lot of events, and it's gonna be hard to get emails. Do you have any thoughts on getting phone numbers in situations like that?
I'll start, but I'm sure you both have a ton of ideas too. There's a ton of signage that goes into any of those events, and having text to subscribe, calls to action, like text in to this number to receive, that's an easy addition to the signage that you have at those events. Any of this kind of social media marketing that you're doing for those events, some of that can be drawn to sign up pages or can include text to subscribe, calls to action in there too. And then I know, you know, even just the act of the permitting and the licensing, there's a lot of information that you're collecting in those applications and those processes. Just having a little box, a checkbox that people can click that, you know, gives them the space to say, yes, send me more information, is another path toward having that opt-in when you're already collecting a lot of information from them anyway.
Yeah, it's almost easier for the on-the-go audience and you're out. I mean, especially QR codes are more prevalent. I mean, I had to use it to order tapas last night, I'm pretty sure, to pull up the menu or something. So.
And the tapas were delicious.
Amen. And if I can figure it out, you know, I watched my dad pull up a beer menu with the QR code like last week. So like those mechanisms are like more prevalent and usable. So it's in those like on the go captures, yes. But a thing like an application or a permitting screen, perfect opportunity to opt into those reminders. And you'll start to see it maybe if you pay attention. Scroll to the bottom, the little checkbox is click here to receive more updates from Delta about upcoming trips to Cancun. You know, so those little opt-ins are sort of sprinkled throughout those various processes and digital properties.
Great, thanks.
I think you guys covered it. I don't have anything to add.
Well, Josh had mentioned, you know, in your messages you put from TPWD in it to try to like showcase the authenticity of it or that it's not spam. from other clients you've worked with, obviously it's all government agencies. Have you seen other ways that groups have tried to show that it's not spam, or you know, that it's a legit government agency sending you this text?
It's a continuing, you know, partnership and frankly challenge to stay in good standing as government communicators with some of these wireless carriers, unfortunately. Things like adherence to best practices on your opt-in, having the product name or product description, which was a requirement in the opt-in message, but a part of that conversational reminder. It's an excellent best practice that Josh highlighted to have that from TPWD in the content itself. It creates that trust. And the reminder, if people get however many text messages a day, they may not remember what 877-321 is or whatever the short code is. So having that reminder, it just builds that familiarity in that conversation too. So if you can spare the 10 characters or whatever, it's worth its weight in gold for sure.
Great. I have one more question, I think, before we open it to the audience. You mentioned different cell phone carriers. Do different carriers have different capabilities or different analysis that they can give you when you're texting?
It comes all through the CTIA agency that Nick was speaking to. They're operating as a sort of collective that's providing those requirements and recommendations and best practices for communicators, leveraging them. So I don't know, Nick
right.
might
yeah,
have a different perspective.
In terms of an agreed upon adherence of standards,
yeah.
in tracking or additional features or functionality that AT&T provides versus Verizon, not really. The most that they're providing is the positive assurance that the message was handed off to the handset, like down to the person.
Gotcha.
So that's pretty much as specific as information in an SMS can get, to your point about, you know, limitations. It's at the link level, essentially, is where the tracking is, aside from did the message get delivered successfully. That's all the providers are providing back, or a stop request that they're receiving too, which you have to honor immediately.
Yeah, and to kind of piggyback on that, utilizing the Gov Delivery platform, you still technically have to send an email, but rather than uploading email addresses as the subscriber list, you upload phone numbers.
Gotcha.
So an email doesn't go out to anyone but me or a couple people that are copied on it, mm-hmm. and it just says, this is an email, or this is a text. So
gotcha.
We can track how many of the text messages were delivered successfully, but then we have to utilize something like a Bitly or something mm-hmm. to track the actual links,
gotcha.
The clicks on the links, sorry.
Which your link is in compliance and good because it is branded and proprietary. It says TPWD in the link. So not all short URLs are bad, but the point is if you can't just go to bit.ly.com and like whip one up for free, that's when you get into trouble.
Gotcha, okay, thanks. Do we have any questions from the audience about texting? Got one down up front here. We can bring the mics.
I'll go first. have you done any A/B testing on whether texts perform better with or without photos or videos?
We have not because we only have SMS capability currently. We can't do a multimedia message. I don't know if other clients.
Out of Gov Delivery, it is SMS. So MMS, mixed media, is, a fertile ground for testing. You can see studies out there about some specific case studies about imagery working well. It's a best practice anywhere. Imagery creates emotion and reminders and action. So if you have channels that are able to deliver images, videos through that, absolutely. I think links to those resources and a clear call out to what they're engaging with. A very compelling SMS message. All of the great engagement that Janice highlighted with the Instagram Reels yesterday, for example. So a share call to action to share this with someone that it reminds you of, for example.
I think there's one down here.
She beat me to the punch with the A/B question, so thanks for asking that already. I also had a question, Joshua, about did you guys use a control group for that messaging campaign to measure lift?
We did, actually. We held out, I think it was about 4 or 5% of the overall audience, so the 400,000 messages that went out was about 5% of those. The experiment group outperformed the control group across the board. Percent of sales was higher, clicks was higher, everything about it was better, so rather than people receiving no texts.
Sure, thank you.
We've run longitudinal holdout experiments with SMS over the course of years, and this was the first year with this program specifically where they said that we're not gonna do this anymore. Like, the proof is there. We're gonna send it to everybody because they just get that much more impact out of it. But test it with your audience, obviously, yeah.
Do I have one, Nicole?
For that initial opt-in message where you say frequency, if you're just getting started and you kind of are conservative, do you have to update that estimate over time, or how does that work?
Yeah, from the short code application process, the compliance, the most important thing is consistency. If you have 3 messages a week on the opt-in form and it says up to 5 in the message, that's where the problem is. Be upper estimates of it, you know, and being honest too and conversational about the people after, as you're starting to create that conversation with SMS, like, here's what we're going to text you about. We'll send you roughly monthly reminders. It just builds that trust. But for the frequency requirement specifically, consistency, you don't have to be exact. Things like up to 3 messages a week are you know, give you that wiggle room. Compliance-wise, yeah.
And it's okay if, like, seasonally you were going to ramp up, you would just pick the highest amount that you
right.
thought you were going to do.
Message frequency varies is acceptable.
Okay.
And as long as it's consistent throughout the various places, that's fine. Yeah.
Thank you.
Do we have any more questions?
All right, back here.
All right.
Question about, I guess, the difference between transactional and marketing. Have you done anything on the transactional side? And if you have, are you using, I don't know what the actual word is, but like a separate domain if we were to talk about email, or a separate IP address? I don't know what that would be called on the SMS side.
We were able to track through Google Analytics from each of the unique UTMs within the text messages, how much revenue was attributed that clicked through. We use Gordon Darby as our licensing system. So if they clicked the link on the text message and then went all the way through the license purchase process, we were able to track that revenue back to that specific UTM from the text message.
But you haven't done anything on the transactional side in regard to SMS?
This was our first endeavor into transactional texting.
Okay.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
So just this so far, we're hoping to expand it into other realms.
In true transactional use cases, we didn't get into this in the presentation, there's a difference between one message SMS campaigns and recurring message campaigns. Most of the SMS marketing that we'll be doing are recurring message campaigns. It's more than one. Single message campaigns are things like multi-factor authentication, right? You get your login code texted to you. That's an entirely different use case, transactional, than an outbound marketing campaign. So they would be coming from different phone numbers. If I'm going to like an authenticated experience on like a Delta or whatever, to use that example again, and I have that, like, send me a text to log in, it would probably come from a different phone number than the cheap trips to Cancun text message would come, because it ties back to that initial use case that's a part of the application and approval process of getting the phone number checked in with the wireless carrier. So it is very dependent upon use case. So things like transactional SMS are sometimes coming from different phone numbers than something like a outbound one-to-many message would.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
You're all texting right now, aren't you?
We got.
I think we have a question up there.
Janice, yep. Wait.
Thank you. The cost per text, if you were to include an image, would that increase the cost?
I would assume yes. The examples that we're talking about are SMS, so not including text or not including images within the body of the message, but
safe assumption that including media in a message at volume would incur a higher cost and delivery to people's handsets. You're pushing more data over through the network, so they would probably charge you a higher cost for that versus SMS.
Thank you.
We have time for one more?
Yeah. Yep.
Quick question about your kind of base data. You're using a licensing database. Did you encounter any difficulties figuring out, did people who were in that database 10 years ago give you a landline versus what is, you know, what's a number we can use for this campaign? And then did you feed that back in to kind of improve your data as far as, like, you know, where you're sending these messaging?
We just started collecting or requiring a phone number and email address in 2020, I believe. So it doesn't go too far back, but we do get reports back from Granicus as to whether the message was delivered or not and what the issue was. So I'm sure some of those undeliverables were, it says phone, I don't know the exact phrase, but it alludes to the fact that, yes, it was likely a landline. So then we can pull those from the data going forward. And GovDelivery will scrub them typically too if the list is uploaded again or if there's repeat failures to a phone number for whatever reason, they'll remove it after, I think, two to three failures. So we didn't see a huge bounce rate. Like I mentioned, the bounce rate was actually higher on the email side than it was on the phone number side.
There's like APIs and stuff to look it up to see what type of phone number it is, but where that message would fail, if you try to send a text message to a landline, it would be at the handoff. Like, GovDelivery wouldn't be able to successfully hand it off to AT&T or Verizon or whomever. It would fail at that point for a reason defined and then be subject to bounce processing. So a permanent delivery failure, this message would never get delivered successfully to this phone number. Safe to infer it was a landline. There's some reporting around it, too, in the response back from the failed handoff, but...
Great, thank you. Any more? I think we've got time for one more question if anyone has one. All right. Well, thank you all very much. Really appreciate your time and the information. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.